Hello and welcome back to XCOM 2, War of the Chosen. This is the Legendary Ironman Army of 2 run, where we're beating the game on the highest difficulty with only 2 soldiers' permission. My name is Syken, and I am welcoming you back. Finally, Syken is back, and he is in a good mood. Workload has reduced a little bit, and that gives me time to play the games. Which I will, of course, invest to continue this beautiful run. And we are going to go for Operation Storm Song. 15 enemies, a VIP rescue mission. And we do have a couple of nasty enemies there. Heavy mech, codices, specters. So let's take a look at the mission. We are going to go into this mission with our VIP of this run, Mr. Hogbite, the Templar. Who's probably going to carry this all by himself, accompanied by Mr. Mitchell. Mitch, the man with the mustache. It's going to be very difficult, which tells me that there is a high likelihood that either the Chosen One or the Viper King will be on this mission. So we need to watch out and make sure that we are prepared. That's, by the way, also the reason why I bring both of the high-level characters, and specifically Hogbite, with us. We need to make sure that we can go through this mission. VIP missions, in general, in case you didn't know, are rather on the more difficult side on Legendary Ironman, because you run into the situation where you cannot evac in case things are going sour. You are being forced to continue. There's only like one evac spot, and either you make it or you don't. Plus, you do have a pretty strict timer on your head, which means for us, we really need to get going and be successful. Anyways, I'm very much looking forward for this mission, guys. It had been such a long time since I played, and I actually missed the game quite a bit. Secure the VIP and proceed to the evac. Lots of high ground here, and here, and just a tiny little bit of normal ground, and yet again more high ground. That is awesome. I love it. It also means we can double move. Very good. Worked like a charm. So, as always, we want to be very careful with our VIP. Five hit points that deep into the game are no longer anything that can survive a single hit. So, short of the sectoid, which can hit for less than 5. I think everything would deal more damage than 5 hit points. And the VIP doesn't even have armor or any chance to dodge shots. Which means, in short, we want to make sure that we're not getting hit. Confirm. Moving over. Seeing the... Oh, look at that. Look at that. The Viper King is over here. Interesting. Let's check the hack first, because you always should check the option to hack. Immediately gains concealment. Squad gains concealment. Yeah, and we don't want to alert everyone. That would be unwise. So it's a niche hack. We could use it later just to get through. But I think it wouldn't even count for the VIP, so that in itself makes it useless. Nice, great execution. Not sure if this is going to trigger the. The Viper King. I know the Viper King was like here. So this here looks awfully close. But what if... we are attacking from this side, in which case the full cover here would be in the way. Let's try this, because I also don't want to waste time. Okay, that seemed to work out. We get some extra focus. And let's give ourselves parry. We are going to hunker down with the VIP. There's the Blade Storm. Nice little hit. And that should give us even more focus. No, it doesn't. Oh, there is an Andromedon back here, so we need to be very careful. Okay, with the Viper King, things are a bit different since it can react to all of our actions, short of the free actions, which we're of course trying to use. There we go, just softening it up a little bit. Hit points, all right. We are in ranges, so as soon as we would do anything with Mitchell, he would indeed trigger a reaction. This here most likely is going to trigger the reaction of the Andromedon and pull it, but there's only so much we can do. We need to kill the Viper King. Thank you. So we need to kill the Viper King because every action that we're doing will trigger a counteraction. For those of you who are not familiar with it, basically the color coding down there will show you, short of the green items, everything else triggers an action. So moving in, taking a hit, disorientating him, that means it can't use its frostbite, triggering yet another attack, because now it's moving. And it is summoning a gate. Interesting. Well, we don't want that. So might as well. And this is only a 79% chance. I do have a better idea. We give ourselves a protocol that triggers threat assessment. And now he will move. And we can take a reaction shot, which unfortunately missed, but the chance for the reaction shot was higher than the chance of hitting it in full cover. I know, sounds crazy, but it was definitely a better chance. Unfortunately, it did not work out. So the Viper King was fleeing with, I think, 4 hit points. Yeah, we're going to encounter it in 2 to 3 missions again for the third and hopefully last time. God, and I was hoping we would be done with it. We know there is another Andromedon over here. So the question is, do we go for Reaper or not? We are reloading and we can go for an Overwatch. If we would go for Reaper, there's a 50-50 chance that we're even triggering it because we're dealing 9 to 10 damage. So instead, what I think makes more... Oh, wait a second, I do have an idea. We can start softening it up with a pistol shot. Yeah, but that missed. Okay, unfortunately, that did not work out. So how about we are just attacking it. We will trigger the Andromedon, but that's okay. We do have parry. And since we would have had Bladestorm anyways, even if we wouldn't have killed it right away, any action next turn would have killed it. So that was the momentum that triggered.
On my way.
We continue to further move in. And we're going to parry. The Andromedons seem to have moved on. Okay, good enough. We're probably going to summon the ghost because we still have 10 turns and I feel that we are in a very, very strong position here. We're giving up high ground, which I seldomly do. And instead, we're going to summon the ghost.
Rise and serve.
As a scout. But also as a third... as a third operative. Alright. Moving in with the ghost. Easy enough. And let's get the VIP. So far so good. We still have 10 turns.
Moving to Overwatch.
Alright. Here we go. So we killed a pack of two, the first pack of two, that's four down, and the Viper King I think did not count against the 15, we couldn't scout it. So we are looking at four down and quite a bit more to go. Which is the perfect time to trigger what appears to be three packs at the same time. Wow. And I felt we somewhat got it under control. Okay, good. Well, one thing after the other. So if we were to take shots, that's only a 44% chance. We could move here into indestructible full cover, giving us a chance to see the codex and kill it, which is probably a pretty decent idea.
Moving out.
Unfortunately, it dodged. Yeah, we would trigger two additional packs if we were to go, two additional soldiers if we were to go in. Question is, does that matter at this point in time? The answer is probably not. Let's think about how we are playing this out. I would say going for a Reaper kill, then going for another Reaper kill, and probably setting up for a solid attack over here might be not the worst idea. Again, all of them only have one action because we triggered them on our turn. So this here will deal some extra damage to the Andromedon.
I strike for my people. Advent awaits us.
All right. So this here would kill and set up for even more kills on the other codex. Okay, why can't I get this codex here? Because this codex here would be exactly the codex that I've been looking for. That's unfortunate. And what's a good strategic position? That's the next question. So if we were to Iconic Storm, for instance, like here, that wouldn't hit enough. Just trying to find a couple of spots where we would deal maximum amounts of damage. So that's three of them that we could hit. Or the two there. As much as I hate to say it, but I think this here is probably the most efficient way of using it. Might be hitting three. Not sure, probably only two to be honest. Really hard to tell. Oh, we can only hit two. Pretty sure this is limited to two targets only. The storm, however, would clear out a lot of the enemies because we still have Reaper, and with that we could set up for some really really nice kills. I am tempted. Kind of the downside would be that the ghost would die afterwards. Another option, just thinking out loud now. Another option would be to simply use the ghost, move in, hit one of them, position ourselves well, and soften the guy up as much as possible so that we can finish him. Yeah, probably not worth it. If we were to vault, that'll hit 3, but the damage is neglectable. Not enough to set them up for kills. Would need to be maximum damage almost. And it's jumping only to 2 to maximum 3 targets in this case. Yeah, the ionic storm is better. Question is, I've never used it on a ghost. It usually uses up all of your focus. The Templar ghost, however, only uses 1 focus per action. So probably that's not even going to spend all of the focus, which would be even better. Anyways, we're going to find it out. Wow, very, very solid damage. We don't want to go behind the Andromedon. Given where we currently are, and since they only have like 1 movement turn, might as well just go up here and force them to move and find us. No one can directly see us up here, so everyone would at least need to do 1 movement action, which is perfect. And time to hide the VIP. The Sun Lancer. tries to move closer. So we could move all the way down here, just man-moded, and tank them, which wouldn't be the worst idea. Again, Ionic Storm. Could act as a pretty solid damage boost here. We do not have Reaper yet. We could easily kill the Stun Lancer here, not even a problem. The Overwatch is an issue. We're going to have two Andromedons here. So the question that I'm asking myself is it worthwhile focusing on the Andromedons for now, or just cleaning up the rest? So that's one down. This here would solve the Overwatch problem and would also solve the problem with the Andromedon, and so it's probably going to be our preferred course of action if we were to hit this here. It'll remove the Overwatch. We are going to kill the one Andromedon. It'll reduce itself to the shell, but that's okay. Shell will not immediately attack us if it's on the enemy turn. It'll just move towards us, and that's it. The other guy, we can block the other Andromedon. He's going to be an unknown. The Stun Lancer will move down, try to Stun Lancer us. Bladestorm will kill it. So Stun Lancer is dead, he's an unknown, the Andromedon here will die on its turn, and this Andromedon cannot do anything. So I think that's the best course of action. Alright, we got the parry figured out. A turn still more than enough time. VIP needs to be completely out of the zone. We have two more back here. Wait a second, let's remember real quick. Like, we triggered an Andromedon plus X, that Andromedon moved in. No, the Andromedon is still there. I think we have triggered three Andromedons. One was here, one was here, one was here. So there's another Andromedon back here and another soldier. There's a Stun Lancer here. We killed all of the codices. I think there was still a captain here who is now out of line of sight. I forgot about him.
move.
So moving out of range. Okay, good. Question is, do we want to give 8 protocols so that we do have threat assessment? The answer is probably yes, because it also gives defense, and that means Hogbite might not be hit as much. All right, hunker down. Nice. It's a beautiful blade storm. Perry will go into the melee attack. Melee attack also shatters all of the cover. Great little Overwatch. Blade storm kills him. That means only the shell is left over. Shell will not attack immediately. Superior expanded magazine is great. And the Alarum core is also not bad. Okay, so there is the captain. Sound Lancer will die, as predicted. And we still have threat assessment left over. Okay, good. Back in. Let's try to kill the Andromedon shell. Nice little extra damage. Great. Okay, we got some extra hits that we could pull off. But we also got 2 Overwatches. Let's take a look. So these are 100% hits. That's a 50-50 to get rid of the Overwatch. This guy here is dead. As soon as he moves, Blade Storm will trigger. So we could play it in 2 different fashions. We could go for the captain and just make sure that the captain dies, but that would leave us wide open for some attacks of the Andromedon. Once you're so close to the Andromedon, it usually uses melee attacks. However, even with full focus level, we can't kill it with one shot. It still has 4 armor, so that's the problem. If we go for the captain, we would need to get rid of the Overwatch, and that means all of our shots are going to go into removal of Overwatch. The Andromedon shell will definitely die because Bladestorm will trigger it, which means I'm wondering if we should just use our fire to actually kill or at least injure the elite officer and go for another parry play here. It's probably what we're going to do. Even if this misses, we still got 2 free shots off. Yeah, there we go. A little bit of damage. It's never wrong. This shouldn't kill him. Great. Perfect. That's exactly what we wanted, because now we can parry, which means we do have a free parry, and both of the shells will die from the Bladestorm attack. And we get 1 parry left over. There you go. Shell is dead. The Andromedon is dead. The shell itself will not move. Will not attack this turn. Oh, the Andromeda, the other Andromedon is on top of the roof. Oh, and the shadow is, the Spectre is starting to move in. That's a bummer. Spectre double moves, interesting. At this time they are overwatching, I assume, because they don't want us to move closer to the extraction location. Very interesting move of the AI. So we still got one or two more rounds, but it's getting really, really close. So let's optimize our activities here. Going to heal ourselves. We're going to almost kill the Andromedon shell. Injured enough so that one hit would kill it. We can move all the way up and attack the Spectre. Problem with the Spectre is probably can't outright kill it. Unless we're dealing really high damage with the pistol and then begin to melee attack it. So let's go, let's try this. Nice. I'm very afraid of the potential takeover capabilities of the Spectre, because they are nothing to sneeze at. I'd rather take two Overwatch shots here than having the Templar taken over. And by the way, for those of you who asked why I would stack dodge on the Templar, that's exactly why. Have you just seen how he got hit twice and he just shrugs it off? Two dodges in a row. Because he can. Because he can. We're going to go for one parry. Let's not mess up the VIP. It's very important that we stay out of line of sight. Alright, first shot parried. Great. Nice little Bladestorm attack. Well, he missed, but both of them fell down. So that's some damage for the Templar regardless. Another Bladestorm attack. Hawkbite is shredding through them. I love it. Adorable. Adorable. Okay, so five more turns. That's one. And we gotta keep moving, so no more healing for now. Moving out. A Let's shred the Andromedon. Well done. So that'll be enough to kill it right away. Let's hurt the trooper just a bit. The other two next to the Templar are already in lethal range. And we are. Going to hit them both. Going for parry. Four more turns. That's 1, 2, 3. Okay, so. We're going to hunker down. Oh my god. He missed the grenade. That is rare. I think the grenade would have killed us. Oh my gosh. I almost fucked up the mission. Okay, time to move. Moving. And time to actually kill this guy here. That's what you get for attacking our VIP. That was not very nice. Let's maximize the damage. We're first taking a pistol shot. We are then going to attack and rent. And we're going to parry the VIP. Stubble moving. The Andromedon suit will actually kill itself due to Bladestorm. And that should be the mission. So now, since all of the entryways up there seem to have been barricaded, the shortest way is actually moving up here and back there. Are you serious? We're barely getting out of here. Okay. That's a close one. Good. Very close. One more turn. Mitch will just barely make it out as well.
Status confirmed, on the move.
It was as difficult as I would have expected, and not everything went according to plan, specifically when we pulled four packs at once, which was a bit of a surprise to me. Running into the fray, and then just next thing you know is you pulled the entire map. Good job.
According to Advent officials, recent attacks by dissident elements operating outside of the city centers.
But that's exactly the type of action we want to see. So Syken is back, and he still has got the tendency to pull the entire map at once. Talking about fighting against three Andromedons, one Spectre, two Codices, two elite soldiers, one captain, and what was the last thing that we fought? Oh yeah, a Stun Lancer. At the same time, because we can. Great. Hogbite really carried his weight. I must congratulate him. That was an awesome turn. Really well done.
Hello, Commander.
And we got 95 intel on top of it. So that is good. Let's take a look about where the game currently is standing. We're having 380 intel. I will check the black market very soon. As of now, our armory looks as following. We have Zirkim, who is tired, and his comrade Renven, who is injured. So both of them are ready in 3 days. Hogbite also takes 3 days. And coincidentally, Roby, who's on a covered mission, takes another 3 days. So all of them are out. We do have the last team, Edgar, Alien, Poe, and Outrider, who would be available for any sort of non-timed missions. Rat is a colonel who we recently got as a reward. Yeah, and then Mitchell plus two additional captains. That's pretty much what our team is currently looking like. So having all of these alloys, I think we can take a look how much we want to sell at the black market. We don't need intel right now. I know that we've just reduced contact, or we were just trying to reduce contact cost just to save some more intel. Let's see what we've got here. Superior conditioning and superior perception. Wow, how can I pass on that? We're definitely going with a superior perception. That's a non-brain. We should immediately go for that. The superior conditioning is actually also really good, specifically since we don't have too many PCSs at the moment. Yeah, might as well go for it. We are also a bit short on supplies. Seldomly bought supplies for intel. But let's see what we could do with the supplies. And as for selling, a couple of corpses, the Archon corpses, very interested, are also a good starter. We're not selling those because these here are intel. So it's basically a worse trade than the one that we currently could buy at the black market. We might be able to sell some alien alloys. That was suggested from one of the viewers, and I do agree. That's not a bad idea. What do we need money for? I remember that we had quite some projects on the way. So let's take a look. Hello, what Commander. Exactly we need. We need money for oh yeah, the upgrades. I do remember that. So we could upgrade to Gremlin Mark II, or we're going for Gremlin Mark III to begin with. I think we're going to wait for Gremlin Mark III. The Balpup, we don't need that at all. because we're not using the skirmisher, but the fusion blade could be something that we actually use. The fusion X even more. 160 supplies is nothing to sneeze at though. So yeah, fusion X and probably the gremlin, but we can wait with the gremlin. So that's one of the things we could do. What else? None of those. I think we're fine with the communication that we do have. Yeah, we are absolutely fine. I know we wanted to upgrade. We maybe wanted to upgrade some of our gear. The Wrath suit definitely comes to mind. 125 supplies. That'll be an option. Frost bomb could be an option. Advanced explosives quite generally would be not too bad, but that is referring to all other explosives other than the normal plasma grenades, which we already have maximized. So that's probably not worth the 75 supplies right now. And last but not least, we do have a couple of combat tactics actually that might be helpful. Increase hacking for Dragunova. I like the idea with the advanced security towers. That's not bad. Biggest booms, definitely worth. This would be great for Roby. All of it 200 a pop, by the way. So it's. I mean, the only thing that we have is the Templar so far. 10% extra damage. At the end of the day, these flat bony are all quite handy. Oh, I remember why we needed money. Now it all comes back. Here's the deal. We needed money because we wanted to do the beam cannons, and with the beam cannons we wanted to upgrade the last item, the last guns to plasma. So we're going to save our money quite well, because that's going to be expensive.
But eventually she's going to have to trust me if we're going to achieve our goals.
But I would want to go for one Wrath suit, because I really think that it's worth it. And I like the extra mobility. I'll send word when the project is complete. And knowing that we are so tight on cash, we're going to do two things. Number one, we're trading in some intel for supplies. Which sucks, I know, because intel is great. And supplies are, yeah, necessary. And we are going to trade in some of the alloys. Yeah, that's good enough. So we're looking at 400. We can always get a bit more. Anyways, reduce contact cost effectively is the same as if we would be getting some more intel, because it reduces contact costs for long range contacts. We just got all negative traits removed, which leads me to the question, do we have someone who needs negative trait removal? No. Apparently I've done that all. All the ones that need negative trait removal are currently not available. Good, next region reduction by 50%. And I think we're going to make contact here. The only thing that I don't like about it is this here might get us into contact with the third chosen. That would actually suck. Yeah, question is, do we want to prevent that from happening? A third chosen means a third one is going to take actions against us. It's potentially three chosens that are trying to shoot down the Avenger. But on the other hand, we would get double agent, which is a super strong bonus this here plus our bonus from Africa, where we are having voluntary army, means almost in every mission we do have a very solid chance that we are 3 instead of 2. So let's take the supplies, and then I think we're going to make a contact, although I'm almost 100% sure that that'll mean we're going to be in contact with the hunter. Yeah, can't change it though. At some point we need to discover him. Very nice. Look at that. John got 10 dodge, which is great, and has increased to gifted, so he'll actually get a lot more combat experience now. So that will help him to progress. Let's look at the options that we do have here. We might want to already prepare going to find the hideout of one of them, because otherwise it takes a longer time. This here is will plus 4, aim plus 3. Health plus 1 is really good, but superior weapon upgrade is so and so. This here is not bad. I like the breakthrough research. An additional upgrade slot, N plus 1 mobility, both of that is useful. Health plus 1 is always useful, so that's not bad. The promotion is okay for our majors. Superior PCS is also not too bad. I was hoping that we could get some more dodge. How long is the month? How long is the month? So we're looking at 18 days, which means we can easily do some of the stuff. I think just realistically speaking, we might want to look into mobility to further increase our mobility, and the upgrade for the gun is actually pretty decent, so there is almost no downturn. And then we might want to go for health plus 1 and start going for the good old warlock so that we find his hideout. That as a combination could be a good starter. So who needs speed? It's probably going to be Hogbite to further increase his mobility, and we want to prevent him from being wounded, so Cyber helps him, which means 7 days, we got a breakthrough plus 1 mobility. That's pretty much a no-brainer. Really solid. Good. Easy peasy. And yep, that's pretty much it. Okay, so we got enough supplies. 700 is really good. Allows us to upgrade the beam weapons. Let's make contact. We're still fine on intel.
Attempting to establish local regional contact.
Dragon rounds is okay. It adds plus 1 damage to the weapon, and it can be okay against strong melee opponents, such as berserkers, because then they can't hit you in melee. Fire prevents them from attacking. So that's not bad. It has its it has its usage. Not my favorite type of ammunition though. This here is good. This here is very good. All right, beam cannon, great. Improves the efficiency of raw energy, will reduce construction cost of Illyndrium conduct. Yeah, not worth it. Instead, we might want to look into the sector port breakdown to get the highest level of our gremlin. That's pretty convincing. The other option would be to get additional intel via the alien cache. Yeah, we're probably going with the sector port first. Gatekeeper for the highest psionic wouldn't mean much for us because we're not playing with psionics in this run. Yeah, the others are all okay, but we haven't really used them. I think the sector port is the most important one for now.
Just give the word and I'll get started, Commander.
Good. Build items, weapons, beam cannon as an upgrade. So worthful. Really good. So that's a good upgrade. The question that I'm asking myself is, shall we go for Fusion X first or for the upgrades in our GTS? Probably one of each. So we're going for Fusion X instead of Fusion Blade. Because we anyways only have one Ranger, might as well use the Fusion X then. And as a second one, we can upgrade one of the GTS. New combat tactics. So I like this here, which makes the Ranger so much stronger. I also like the extra ability aim and crit chance. That's not bad either. I like this here, just to increase the stealth. But I think we're going with Hunter's Instinct. I personally think that's one of the stronger abilities, very synergetic with what the Ranger is anyways doing. And it gives a flat plus one damage, which is nice. Okay. So we are broke again. Look at that. There we go. Operation Rotting Rain. What a beautiful, beautiful name. We are going to see that in the next mission. It's probably time to use Zirkim and Renman. Just to have that extra firepower that we need on the Haven assaults. I'm very much looking forward for that mission, so stay tuned. We are going to look through that in the in our next episode. If you enjoyed what you've seen, support the channel, give it a like, give it a thumbs up, leave a comment, and share your thoughts. I really, really like the interaction with the community. That is probably the most entertaining part for me on being on YouTube. So keep it going, guys. Love to hear back from you. See you later and have a great evening. Bye-bye.